So run away now if you want to. Otherwise, this is the 2019-2020 C3 capstone handoff. We'll go ahead and if you're here and not on the capstone, feel free to interrupt and ask questions. And we'll go for an hour, maximum hour and a half. And go, guys, go.
Okay, so this is the C3 capstone project. I think Mikhail wanted to do the kickoff.
So we went back to the old page. We're leaving the prototype on there because that's, you know, a separate project and we just want to keep it on there just because. The next one is our board. We don't have pictures of it with the flat set. So we just went with the picture of the Rev 3, our newest Rev. And it has a link down at the bottom for the document, for just our Google Doc. So just kind of try to keep all that stuff close together. All right. So since we're here, do you want to go to the documentation or would you think it would be better to go through GitHub? I guess let's go through the GitHub then if we want to scroll back up.
Sure.
Cool. So, the documentation that has some stuff on there, videos, notes. This is just kind of a backup for Google Docs, but it's not really, that's not really its prime functionality.
What are the videos?
Those are videos from, I believe, the prototype, the practicum that we did. We just wanted to make sure that we kept them somewhere that we could find them, and we wanted like redundant places in case something horrible happened.
Okay.
So that's really the point of just this doc folder. Going back, we have the bomb, so it's in a easily located place. This is the bomb for our V2, right? Yeah, it says it right there, V2. And that's for the last one that we actually sent out. And Andrew has that currently, I believe. Right. Yep. And okay, so back again. And then we have our Eagle schematics, which are, that's Mark.
Okay, so from here, we've got our Eagle schematics, and basically what we've brought ourselves up to is these six sheets here. We've got our connections, our power.
Hold on, sorry. If you're going to do documentation, before we jump into the whole schematic and everything, Google Docs and also the 10,000 foot view.
Cool. So you want us just to show you where stuff is, right?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. All right, then let's go back and let's go. Yeah, there's the docs.
So it's inside Orset shared drive, inside C3 card.
Yeah.
So go to C3 card for just a minute.
Yep. Boop. And then there's the 2019.
Okay, great. So go ahead. Yep, go ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and you've got your capstone report and final reports. And is final reports going to be where the final report lives?
Yes.
Yes.
So why don't you go in there for just a minute since that's an important handoff part.
Yeah. The user manual is the correct one. The capstone report, that was the one that we were not sure about. And that will
be... Do you want to go ahead and open this one up?
Yeah, go ahead. Great, and then just kind of go through it, or just scroll through it. So this is your final report that you're handing off to us.
Yes,
correct.
Okay, and it goes over subsystems. That's great, and it goes over test stuff. Okay, good.
It's important to note that this links to some other important documents.
So this links the functional description, which has a bunch of level one block diagrams and then just like overview functionality. And it also links to, it doesn't link, but it like important documents that are referenced. It also references the test plan. So just to make it clear that, you know, there's stuff that you should really look elsewhere for, and we talk about it.
Right, well, let's go back and show us all that stuff then. Where is all that stuff?
Cool, that should be in our doc also.
All right. So test plan. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. You don't have to make it. That's fine. We can see it.
This test plan was intended to test the Rev 2 board, or to what extent does the test plan cover?
Two or three.
Yeah, okay. The newer ones.
Okay, because I recall Robin and I discussed strategies on testing some of the RF stuff, which
I don't believe that we've made that many changes to RF between two and three.
Two and three. Okay, all right.
Yeah, so it's everything that's on the if the board that we've ordered gets stuffed, then this is the test plan you'd use to test it.
Yeah.
Great.
Let's see. Oh, yeah. We'll go back. And functional description.
Yep.
And there's that Rev 2 again. I think that's just hanging out from something that we stole it from before.
No, that, yeah.
Yeah.
Is that Rev 2 of the document or Rev 2 of the board?
I think it was just something that we stole and it doesn't actually belong there because we just didn't delete it because it's tiny.
I'll scroll up and you delete it.
Magic.
So in here, level 0.
Okay, great.
Let's see. What other documents?
Our progress reports.
Will you guys go into data sheets for just a minute?
Sure. Sure.
Yeah.
Okay, unfortunately, you need to remove all these data sheets. Oh, no, this is, never mind.
Yeah, it's Google Docs.
Never mind. Good. Okay, so you guys deleted them in there. That's great. Okay, go back.
Yeah, we moved them to the Google Doc.
Thank you.
Yeah. So your concern was that they're not on GitHub.
Correct.
Yeah.
All right, and then progress reports and meetings. Okay, that's fine. We don't need to see those.
Okay.
And then what's on the root down below? Scroll down.
The SEAM 4.
Yep. All right, good.
Project proposal.
And then, okay, good. This is great. Why don't you start from a quick overview for people who are on board who don't know what the hell the C3 is and go over it in the block, the sort of level 0 and maybe level 1 block diagram, and then let's start hitting it. Because remember, you're essentially handing this off to the next generation of PSAS people, whoever that is.
Yeah.
Okay.
Would you like this from our documentation, or would you like this from our schematic?
I
just the overview.
Yeah.
So the overview is this is a cube satellite that's being built here in Oregon. It's the first one, and it will be launched into space winter 2021. What we're primarily working on for this CubeSat is the C3 board, which is handling the command, communication, and control of the functions of the satellite.
So it has to survive in space, and it has to, that surviving in space is a lot of different things, but the main problem with it is all the components have to be off the shelf.
So I would strongly suggest starting with the level zero block diagram, going to level one, and then hitting the schematic.
Cool.
So I guess people be quiet here, but I'll jump in.
Can somebody mute whoever's having a lot of feedback?
It's Glenn.
It's me?
Yep, thanks.
All right, go ahead. Yeah, okay, so just a broad overview. The C3 card is kind of analogous to a motherboard of a computer. It's got the main components are the MCU, which is a microcontroller, which is kind of like the brains and of the satellite. And it's got some onboard memory. It's got two radios, and it's got a functionality that allows it to kind of power cycle any of the cards individually through a subsystem called the ORSAT power domain. And it also has the only rad hard component on the satellite, which is the watchdog, which is basically a circuit that if it doesn't get a signal from the MCU.
Robin, I'm going to stop you for just a minute. So you guys didn't think about this before we had this handoff, which is fine. But think of it this way, right? Which is you're handing this off to someone who's understands the system, but needs to, we're taking them a tour through your capstone. So start with the level zero, and then talk about the inputs and the outputs, and then start going into the level one with the level one block diagram.
Oh, okay. So just don't talk so much about functionality, but just talk about inputs and outputs at this point, at this level.
Yeah, like what goes in and what's going in and out of the C3. As a whole.
Okay. Where does it fit?
Yeah.
Yeah, so it kind of ties together all the different cards on the satellite. It takes in power from the batteries and the solar panels. As you can see, there's 6 to 8.4 volts. It receives radio. And it also receives CAN bus signals over two CAN buses from the other cards. It provides power, 3.3 volts, to the ORSAT power domain. It also controls OPD through a data bus and talks to the other cards over the two CAN buses. Beyond that, it also has a transmit radio to talk to the ground station. And it splits out a GPS signal that it receives onto and sends that back out over the backplane to the GPS card. And beyond this, it also can shut down the whole satellite. So that's kind of like just the broad overview.
Real quick, before we leave this level.
Sorry, Glenn, can you turn down the gain on your mic by a lot?
Okay.
That's all right.
Okay. That's funny. Nothing's changed. Would it be wise to have the ORSAT block diagram somewhere before level zero?
Yes, sure. Or that could be part of that.
Oh, okay. Like to add. Add the ORSAT block diagram. Yeah. We hadn't even thought of that.
Yeah.
We're too focused. Not sure where that is.
Then you see where C3 fits in the entire world of things.
Yeah.
Right. Yep, that's right. That's fine too. Although let's continue. Let's just assume that they know that. So let's keep going.
Okay. So diving in a little bit more, you can see that some of the important subsystems is the MCU, the microcontroller, which sits at the heart of the card. And then it's got onboard memory, the eMMC, CAN bus transceivers, two of them. It's got two radio systems, here labeled radio one and radio two. Those are actually, one is a receive only radio, which is radio one, and then one is a receive and transmit radio, which is radio two. The receive only runs on is on L band, the transmit and receive is on UHF band. It has a watchdog timer, which is a circuit that if it doesn't get a signal from the MCU after a certain period of time, it will reset the whole satellite. So basically ties the power of the whole satellite to ground, and all the satellite can then come back up. And then it also has a OPD, which is ORSAT power domain, which is a sub-circuit that exists on all the different cards and is controlled by the MCU. And the purpose of this is, and it is independently powered through the C3 card. And the purpose of this is to enable a C3 card to basically power cycle any individual card in case there's a latch up on that card. Now, if there's a latch up on the C3 card, that's power cycled by the watchdog. That's what basically the watchdog is. And that is the broad overview. Should we just keep going?
That's, I think you should probably jump into the schematic at this point, now that you've gone through the sort of level one.
All right.
We'll start here at the schematic, and what we're looking at is the connectors that we have on our board. This connector here attaches our board to the rail of the ORSAT, the main rail where all the other cards are attached, and provides the power source and communications with other cards and the batteries and solar panels. This connector here is our edge connector and debug. It allows us to do programming of the C3 card. In addition, it has been made sort of universal so that all of the cards can have this card on there and connect to the debug programming board through a flat flex cable. These are our RF connection points, and that's about all for our connections sheet. Moving on, we have our power sheet, where it has all of our current limiters and LDOs, our low dropout regulators. We have the main card supply, and then our radios get their own separate power supplies. So we have one for our L band and additionally for the UHF power. This is the OPD, which we talked about a little while ago, as our circuit breaker. This is a current limiting chip, which limits the amount of current that the other cards on the satellite itself can draw. It has fault protection and thermal protection, which allows us to shut off power if a fault has been detected. Moving on, I'll let Robin
take this one. This is the L-band radio. This is functionally complete. So it's kind of, we got the radio, both radio systems from Vigeli, grad student. This was his master's thesis project. And our basically what we did was take a modular system on a bunch of little EVBs or evaluation boards and put them onto the C3 card, into one PCB with all the other systems. So the L band, like I said, we completed it. I don't know how much detail should I go into with this. Should I just be exhaustive about it, or?
No, I don't think you'd be exhausted, but why don't you kind of just go through it like a block and talk about each block?
Okay.
But we don't need to know each and every detail of the thing.
Okay. So the blocks, starting from the very top, kind of left there, you have the L-band antenna comes in, and then it goes through a bandpass filter into the first stage LNA, which kind of boosts that signal, and then it goes into the, it goes into the RF and GPS diplexer. What that does is splits out the GPS signal, which gets sent back out to the GPS card over the backplane. And then it goes through another LNA and then into a mixer. I should just pause here and just say, like, for those who are into the radio stuff, this is a super heterodyne architecture. So it's got a local oscillator, which basically takes the signal at 12, I think it's 1265 megahertz, and down mixes it to our intermediate frequency. Can you zoom out a little bit? Because this, I didn't sleep very much last night, so I'm not gonna trust my memory, but I think this information is on this card. And so basically that's what you can see, the local oscillator mixes into the mixer. And then that goes to a fifth order bandpass, low pass filter, sorry. And then into the AX5043 radio IC. The operating frequency here is like, it's like 1265. The intermediate frequency is like, 452 to 462. So just thinking about like the things that need to be set up in order for this to, in order for this radio to run, the local oscillator needs to be programmed and the AX5043 needs to be set up in software as well. And so that's the job of the MCU, or if you're in test mode, this is can be done with an Axiom dev board. So that's just something to know. And we talk about that in our test plan. From a functional standpoint, the L-band is designed to basically live and die with the MCU. So there's no, if we set, it's the system's designed, so if the MCU is up and alive, the L-band is up and alive and listening for signals from the ground station. There's no way to like power cycle it or do anything like that. So there's like a latch up on the L-band radio. I think the only way to really do that is to bring it back up is to power cycle the whole satellite. So that's a consideration. Then we can go on to the UHF. So the UHF system is actually designed to be both transmit and receive. For as far as we got with this project is we implemented the whole receive side. The UHF receives at 435 megahertz. And it both transmits and receives at the same time. So talking about what we have, you can see here the at the top end of at the antenna, you have a single pole double throw RF switch, which basically is controlled by the AX5043, the push to talk signal. So if it's transmitting, it turns on the transmitting leg. That signal goes high, and I think it turns on the transmitting leg. If it's not transmitting, it goes low, and then it turns on the receive leg. It's kind of like a walkie-talkie. That's why it's called push to talk. So you have that switch. Then that goes into a bandpass filter, into LNA, into another bandpass filter. And since this is just receiving at a frequency that is within the range of the AX5043, there's no need to downmix or to use super heterodyning. So that just goes straight into the transceiver. I didn't actually talk about this on the L-band side, but both radios receive their reference clock from a 16 megahertz TCXO, which is a temperature controlled crystal oscillator, which is powered by its own 1.8 volt LDO. Can we go back to the L-band sheet real quick? And if we look at that, what on this sheet, the AX5043 provides a reference signal of kind of, I guess it just passes forward the reference signal of 60 megahertz to the local oscillator. And there's some control over that because there's software running on the AX5043. And I guess, yeah, so as far as the UHF goes, since this is probably one of the more incomplete systems on this, on the satellite, the things that remain that aren't here are the biggest piece is a power amplifier, PA, for the transmit side, and then associated timeout timer. So that's two pretty big components that weren't implemented. The timeout timer is the idea behind that is if it has a power detector, so if the radio stuck transmitting for a certain amount of time, then it's just a circuit that without waiting for something from the MCU, something smart like the MCU, for lack of a better word, it just cuts off power to the transmitter. It's kind of like a watchdog circuit, but for the power, for the transmit radio only. And then I guess if there's no, from the ground station, if something happens and then you notice, oh, well, I guess we're not receiving any, our data isn't going back and forth, then the L-band would then power cycle the, can power cycle the whole UHF band radio through a software switch. So
like where this one, so where the L band lives and dies with the microcontroller, this one is able to shut off so that it doesn't continue to transmit when unwanted.
Right. Yeah. And if there's a latch up on the, on that AX5043, we can, but the other one is still alive. We can power cycle this whole system, and try to get, to bring it back up.
Moving on to the microcontroller. What we had to wind up doing is moving to a larger microcontroller. And I was shown a different way of actually displaying that microcontroller out by ports of the microcontroller. As you can see here, we have the different ports, port A, B, C, D, E, and F, E, and H, rather. These all are connected through buses and are going to other subsystems like the radio. These are the power and coupling capacitors for the microcontroller. And here we have the CAN bus system for communicating two-way between other cards in the satellite. We have the antennas. We're communicating with deploying the antennas and testing and verifying that the antennas have been deployed. There's some debug connectors that go to the edge connector for doing some debugging when obviously not in space. And then we have the connection to the eMMC, the onboard data storage memory that we implemented. Here's our connections to OPD. And along with that, we have a TVS diode. Ian, do you want to go into that?
Yeah, so this is supposed to protect, especially with like electrostatic discharge on both the OPD clock and OPD data lines. With the prototyping board, from what I recall, Mikhail and Robin and them saying Miles had touched the board and there was an ESD event and it damaged those pins on the microcontroller. So we needed to put a TVS diode that can protect against those sort of events, so that if the voltage is too high, like an impulse, it will leak the current through that TVS diode to ground pretty fast. So that is very important. Otherwise, yeah, we can't transmit data, and then the whole mission is done for.
So then we have the clock here for the microcontroller, and we have the output here for petting the watchdog timer circuit, which we'll move on to next. So what we wound up coming up with in place or in lieu of a commercial solution to a Rad-Hard watchdog timer is this circuit here, which could handle the higher voltage input of our shutdown line. Primarily the way this circuit works is if it doesn't receive a PET from the microcontroller within a specified window, specifically less than a PET every second, then it will power cycle the entire satellite. This is the only Rad-Hard component that's on our satellite, and its job is to make sure that the event that the microcontroller could be latched up due to a radiation event, it's able to detect that and restart the satellite. So this is a fail-safe mechanism.
I also want to make a quick note about the watchdog. So originally, at the beginning of Capstone, we had gone with a more expensive IC from a commercial company. And this right here is the best method to go about the watchdog, because it's an open source project. If you think about another organization trying to buy these $600 ICs, this is dramatically cheaper in comparison. So, and we have to thank Andrew for also helping, you know, with the design aspect of it. So.
And then here we have, this is a fairly new addition, is the antenna deployment circuits. And these are, again, responsible for when the satellite is launched out, the antennas are compressed. This is responsible for initiating the deployment of those antennas, both the helical and the turn antennas. Okay. So I'll quickly run through some of the digital stuff on the layout, and then I'll turn it over to Robin rather. So as I was talking about, this section here is the, this is right in here is the deployment part of the antenna, along with a few components over here. Our watchdog is over here in this top left corner. Then here we've got our OPD circuit breaker or current limiter. And here we have some of the low dropout regulators that are providing power for the board itself and other components. And in addition to providing power to the radio, as you can see, it snakes around, comes over to the L-band radio. We've got our new microprocessor. It's a lot larger than what we started with. And if you want, I can show you how we went about laying out the pin usage for that with a spreadsheet. Talk about that later if we have time. Here is the EMMC. It is a ball grid array, as you can see by the pattern. Makes it fun to solder onto a board. Down here, we have our debug edge connector. And those are the main components of this. Robin?
Yeah, you can probably just point out. So in the center of the board, kind of is the L-band. And that's at the very bottom there, you have the AX5043 for the L-band side. And it goes out to standard 0.1 pin capable pinouts so that you can plug in jumper wires to interface with it directly with for example, the Axum board, the dev board, or you can do jumpers, straight through jumpers to have it set, the MCU talk to it. Over on the left-hand side there by VBus, on the blue VBus line, you can see three pins. And those pins are for programming the local oscillator. So again, you can see those pins go out to the MCU, but if you don't want to use the MCU or for some reason it's not ready or whatever, you can also use an Axum dev board to program the local oscillator, because it does need that. All right, and then you can zoom out a little bit. At the very top, keep going of the L-band. you have that first stage LNA, which has a yellow, still talking about L-band on the left, in the middle of the board there.
Oops. Sorry about that.
No problem. You have a first stage LNA and then going into the diplexer for the GPS. So the center pin there is the receive, L-band receive, or the center SMPN. There's three pins, radio pins at the top there. The one on the left-hand side is GPS back out over to the back plane. And the center one is L-band in, and it's pretty, it's labeled, so it's like kind of easy to read if you zoom in a little bit. And so a design choice that we made here is you can kind of see the ground planes, you can kind of see these parallel lines. The L-band and the UHF are both on their own kind of power and ground plane, and those are separate from the rest of the MCU circuitry that Mark was talking about. And this is kind of like, it's not really a separate ground plane because the ground planes meet underneath the AX5043 radios. But we did this as a way to kind of, to improve the radio, the RF hygiene of the radio circuits, because, you have a kind of a mixed mode board here. And then underneath the, both on the L-band side and the UHF side, we have 2.5 volts kind of power plane, because this is a four layer board. You have 2.5 volts kind of like as a power plane running through the whole thing, but at the same time segregated from the rest of the power planes in the board. And those are energized by 2.5 volt LDO, so one for L-band and one for UHF. Okay, so going to the UHF side, it's a little bit simpler. You can kind of see another AX5043 radio down on the very bottom. And then this too has the pin capable, scroll down little bit, it's got the pin capable pinouts, just like the L-band side. And then zooming up, let's see what we got. Yeah, so we just have the one, the RX side coming in from out to the rightmost connector. So that's the UHF in both transmit and receive, and that goes into the switch is kind of like where all those microstrips are coming off of. So future work, we probably talked about this. We probably want to move some of this circuitry over. The PA is like the most power hungry part on this whole, on the whole C3 board, the transmit power amplifier. And we talked about wanting to put it as close to the edge of the board as possible. So I would anticipate, you know, needing to do some rework to kind of move and shift this, maybe you swap the two or figure out a way to kind of get it. Because right now, the way it is, all the receive circuitry is the closest to the board. And architecturally, it doesn't really work from a heat conduction standpoint. Ideally, you would want the TX circuitry with the power amplifier as close to the edge of the board as possible, because it clamps onto the cage, which is metal. And so you can have metal conduction without having to go over or pass through other components. I think that's about it.
So I will talk a little bit more on the deployment circuit. One of the things that we wanted to do was make sure that this was a fail-safe device. And we've done that through redundancy. These are quad transistors, NNP type transistors that are doing the controlling for the deployment of the antennas. And that's about all I think I have to add on that.
Any questions?
Yeah, this is a really simple board. Why did it take you all this time?
Well, this is just the first layer. Oh, we have the other board to show you too.
So I don't have any questions because I've been following this, but I invite other people to ask questions. Even if you think they're totally dumb questions, go ahead and ask. Yeah. I think it's worth.
I actually do have another board.
Is this hey, Mark.
One? Yes.
You could also show the XL pinout thing you made that was.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, honestly, that might be good.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing.
And show where that is in the Google Drive.
So right now, that is living under it's right now it's living in a bad place. It's living under the data sheets under a folder for the ST32F44 series of microprocessors.
Yeah, that's not a great place. Okay,
so I'll probably move that. But what I wound up doing, because we were going from a 64-pin microprocessor and then going to a 100-pin microprocessor, I came up with a spreadsheet to identify where the pin stays as the same function and carries through, and then came out with a physical reference to it, which got kind of big. So let me shrink this down a little bit.
Wow.
But it allowed me to do was have a physical representation of the pins and have it named so that I could easily determine where I wanted a function to be, so that when I was routing it later on the in layout, it would be easier to do and wouldn't have to have as many vias, and traces could be easier to route.
There's your other board.
Yeah, that's a really nice way of doing it.
So damn adorable. I love it.
Yeah, I didn't even know you could do this in Excel.
This isn't Excel, it's Google Sheets.
Well, okay.
Do it in Excel.
Good.
It's like functional art.
Yeah.
Very unique.
And with Miles's help, who's not here, I would be becoming a father. We also added in the function of each of those pins, whether it was output, input, or the pin function itself as F. And there is a legend for that somewhere. Yeah. There was a legend for that. appears to be, it's changing. And the way I did this one also is that from the pinouts, changes here make changes on the physical. So you don't actually make any of the changes on this diagram. This is for viewing. Oh, there's my legend right there. Okay.
Cool. Should this live in a functional description folder or?
Yes.
Okay.
Or something like that. It should not be buried in data sheets, that's for
sure. Yeah.
So I'll ask you guys to move that before Sunday.
Yep.
Okay.
Where all things are.
All right.
You want to go over the debug board?
Sure. Do we want to go through that?
Yeah, I think that's actually interesting to some of the other EEs on board because it's going to affect everything. So yeah, go ahead. Affect all cards.
Let me go ahead and pull that up.
I think my mic is playing tricks on me. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh.
Feedback or overdriving.
Am I doing that now?
No.
It's okay. So I was asking, I assume there's a roadmap that sort of gives a sense of where all the documents are somewhere.
I can make that.
Maybe we should just link to do like would it make sense to have a table of contents on our README for GitHub and this link to all like have links there to all the major documents like this.
Andrew doesn't like it. I can see by his face, but I personally do like that.
If you want to put a README document in the root of the Google Drive, that would be fine.
Okay.
That would be great. You should
point to the important documents, but
not on GitHub.
Yeah, I put that in Google Drive.
Okay.
Why is that? You don't mind me asking. I'm sure you have a good reason.
So this is a push pull kind of thing. We've not yet this summer we're gonna finally decide what the hell we're gonna actually do, which is how do we take this open source project that has all of these technical documents on Google Drive and how do we open source them?
Oh, okay.
The answer is I don't quite know yet, but we're moving to a shared drive and we may make the shared drive publicly readable. And then at that point, I would feel comfortable about linking GitHub to the Google Drive folders for documentation. But I don't right now because it's shared on people's public drives and private folders and it's all kind of a mess. And so that's one of the big projects that we'll be doing is moving PSAS to this new shared drive. And then at that point, we'll probably go through and then relink everything. So blah, 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 blah. It's just not worth it right now. But having a README in the Google Drive of what's important for your capstone, you know, is great. That would be fantastic. Not a huge deal, but that'd be fantastic.
Okay, why don't you
do a board first, since this is kind of a functional board?
Sure. Let's see where that is. There we go. Clean that up a little bit. Okay, so up here at the top is the flat flex ribbon cable for connecting this other.
Say what it is first.
Oh, this is the ORSAT card debug board used for programming, powering, and debugging cards that are inside of the satellite. It was designed so that it could be done in situ. So basically, if the cards were inserted into the satellite, one of the panels was removed, we could still plug this ribbon cable in to the edge of one of the cards that are inside of the satellite. And to do that, we use this edge connector, this flat flex cable. And on here, we have a few debug pinouts here and the ability to provide power. This can be power to the card that's being tested or debugged, or it could also be powered to a external USB device so that if, say, your card that's in the satellite was needing a keyboard, it could be plugged in through this USB port here, and it could be powered externally or through from the card itself through some jumpers. Powering and programming of the cards that this is connected to can be done through the micro USB connectors here. This one goes through a serial to a USB to serial port for also additional programming capabilities. Power for the card under test can be supplied through the USB here or through other means, through the use of these jumpers for selecting. In addition, we have the FTDI, I always mess this one up. FTDI connector.
SWD connector.
Oh yeah, SWD connector. The other one's the FTDI connector. Anyway, and this is also additionally used for programming the microcontroller on the boards. This was something that was proposed by Miles, and I just decided to whip something up together, and then went through an iteration where made a mistake in the edge connector being not reversed, so that it would have to be, have a special cable, but that has been since fixed.
And this is great because it works for all of our cards and all of our microcontrollers, which is fantastic.
Okay. Yeah, any questions?
Okay. Really no questions? I mean, it's a lot. It's one of those things where you just threw a fire hose at us, so it's
yeah. Awesome.
Here's a pretty picture.
It's Orsat.
Can I ask, this is an aside, but any word about campus access in the summer, or is that still to be decided or to be heard about?
Well, we were actually hoping that literally Monday we would start working in the rocket room again, but the state of Oregon just put on everything on hold for a week.
Yeah.
And so PSU just did that for a week. And so as far as I know, we are on hold for at least a week. We are hopeful that we will be able to get to rocket room access in the next 2 or 3 weeks as things settle down. We just don't know.
Okay, just play it by ear.
Right. We have a lot planned for this summer, so it's going to be a super bummer if we can't get into the rocket room.
Yeah.
So the last conversation I recall, there was intent to build the Rev 2 board and to proceed on with the L-band testing, as Robin might have outlined in the testing plan.
Mm-hmm.
And then decide where to go from there. Is that all still?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, well, I'm going to actually, we have more to talk about, but I think I can stop recording the handoff and call the handoff done unless anybody has any further comments or questions.
The debug board, there's description about how to use that. That's a question.
That was outside their scope for the capstone, so I don't believe there is a document for that. Okay. But it's relatively simple and straightforward.
Okay.
Yeah.
Also, I noticed on the board for programming the synthesizer, like Robin pointed out, there's a way to either program it with the onboard M4 or to have an external M4 or using the AXEM board. I noticed that there were no disconnects on those test points. So I guess that's probably a Rev 2 topic.
Oh, you want to be able to isolate it from the M4?
if you were programming it with the AXEM board, how would that work? Would there be a collision, a signal collision? Yeah, you're going right to it. Yep, right there.
Hmm.
So is there a signal collision when, if you were to program it with an external AXEM board, for example? And this is just programming the synthesizer.
The synthesizer. Are those like high Z on the, I remember that being
maybe that's
on the MCU?
Yeah. If that were the case, then there's an, that's a no brainer. Yep. Okay. If you're assuming the M4 is in high Z mode while you're trying to use those pins, then you're good. Okay. I think you just answered my question.
I interrupted you, Robin. Sorry. Did you say you were going to hold that and reset?
Oh, come again?
I talked over you and didn't hear. The idea is that we hold the MCU and reset when we want to talk to the AX5043s, correct?
That's not, I actually don't know. I remember this occurring to me, and I think that someone said that those pins are like default high Z, so you wouldn't, so you could, you could program the LO even if the MCU was running, because those pins are just floating. They're like cut off on the MCU side. I might be wrong about that.
No, you're actually correct about that for the M4. And
sorry, let me be very precise. When the firmware is running on the M4, those are outputs, and the M4 controls those lines completely. In order to get an external thing like the AXEM development board to control those things, then we have to hold the M4 in reset, or program a special firmware that puts them in reset mode after, or high Z mode after it does whatever it does. So that's either a custom firmware image or the M4 in reset.
Got it.
Okay. All right.
All right, yeah. So you might want to have some note about that somewhere. And in specific, I was talking about programming the synthesizer, not the AXEM, but okay. Not the AX5043. Two things being programmed here.
Right. And but that's the same thing, which is if we yes. want to do the bit error rate testing through the X5043s, we have to do the same thing.
However, but with using the X5043s, they have provisions for removing those shunt blocks down there at the bottom, which completely physically isolates it. That's the difference. That's why I was referring to the synthesizer, because they don't have that for the synthesizer. Yes, right there. Those shunt blocks can be removed. You can touch it remotely without bringing the M4 into the picture. But a little bit up to the left there, you see that the synthesizer is not done that way. However, I think holding that M4 in reset mode, you're golden.
Yeah. All right. All right, anything else, anyone?
Just make some note of that somewhere in your work.
Well, okay, I am going to close this up. Congratulations to the C3 team, and congratulations to Miles, who's not here. nice work, you guys. This was a lot of fucking work to do, and you guys did it despite a giant virus. So... nice work.
Good work.
Thank you. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank Very you. Nice.
You could say this board is pretty sick.
How dare you, David?